Thank you all so much for joining us for today's community conversation. We're really excited to be joined here by our guest, Ashley Ratcliffe-Lundy, who is the Director of Communications for We Are Ill. Ashley, thank you for joining us.
Thanks so much for having me.
Where are you based? Are you in California?
I'm based in Long Beach, California. We're a national organization, so our team is distributed all across the U.S.
Okay, I'd love to hear that, especially based on your mission. So talk to me about the mission for our viewers who are being introduced to you all for the first time. What is the mission at We Are Ill?
Yes, We Are Ill is a nonprofit patient advocacy organization that supports, educates, and uplifts Black women living with multiple sclerosis. We are aiming to redefine what sick looks like for Black women living with MS. We do this through educational programming, community, and in-person and virtual events.
Can you dive a little bit deeper into that for me? When you say look to redefine what sick looks like what do you feel sick looks like that really needs a makeover, if you will?
Yes. So it goes into the genesis of the organization. So We Are Ill was founded in 2020 by Victoria Reese. She was diagnosed with MS in 2012, I believe. And when she was diagnosed, similar to my story, I was diagnosed in March 2018. I didn't see myself represented in the MS space. You Google, what is MS? What does it look like? And you don't see a Black woman who's thriving, who has the support of her family and friends, who likes to travel, who's into yoga and is living a full life. And so we redefine what sick looks like by living our lives unabashedly in spite of MS. And so we encourage our community to do that. We educate them on self-advocacy. We educate them on participating in clinical trials and generally just living well with multiple sclerosis.
Let's talk a little bit more about living with multiple sclerosis. When someone as yourself, you know, sort of receives a diagnosis, what are some of the assumptions about how that is going to affect your way of life and your ability to sort of thrive the way that you've described?
Right. So it's a very daunting and scary thing to be told you are now living with a disease for which there's not yet a cure. A number of things came to my head when I was told by my neurologist that I have MS. Will I be able to get married? Will I be able to walk myself down the aisle? Will I, need the assistance of a wheelchair? Will my health deteriorate within a matter of months? All those things, you know, did not come to pass, thankfully. But it's just a very scary thought. And I think that the longer you live with MS, the more you get adjusted to it. Your life becomes, you find your new normal, basically. And you learn to live in spite of MS. So you still do the things that you love to do. I think if anything, MS has taught me to be more intentional with my time, because who knows when my, heaven forbid, my next relapse could happen. So I'm catching all those flights. I'm seeing all my family and friends. I am just living life to the fullest, to the best of my ability. So interestingly enough, MS is considered a snowflake disease because it affects everyone differently. So with me, my first symptoms were numbness and tingling in my left foot, which quickly progressed into what we call foot drop or drop foot. So my foot would drag when I walked. You could literally hear me coming because my foot would slap down on the ground. But for others, it manifests as, you know, optic neuritis, temporary blindness in one eye. The symptoms are so vast. It could be intense tremors. It could be numbness and tingling. It affects your cognitive ability. Some people have brain fog. I experience that all the time. Just cognitive impairment. So it really is unique to the individual who is living with it.
So let's sort of more broadly about the number of women, Black women, who are living with MS. How important was it for you when you were diagnosed to then find your people, find your community? And what have you learned about the size of the community of women who are living with MS?
Yeah, so MS was thought to be an illness that Black people didn't get. Research is showing that's not true. I mean, I'm living with it. We Are Ill team is living with it. Research shows that Black women have a 47% increased risk of being diagnosed with MS compared to our white counterparts. And another recent study shows that the prevalence of MS was equally high among Blacks and whites in the US, despite Blacks being only a fraction of the population, about 13% of the population. So it was really important for me to find my community because I don't have a frame of reference. I didn't have a frame of reference for MS. No one in my family has had it. I didn't have any friends who had it. And so it's a very isolating feeling to be told that, you're living with this chronic illness. And so I set out to find my tribe, and my tribe was, already online with We Are Ill. And once I found that community and began to, dig into, we have a private Facebook group where we have our fellow sisters in MS giving, progress reports about their health, asking questions, asking for advice, and we really take care of each other. We encourage each other. So I think that finding We Are Ill was actually a turning point in my MS journey because it gave me hope, and it just let me know that, like, you know what, you're going to be okay. Victoria's doing it. She's been doing it since 2012. Miss Connie, who was one of our older members, she's in her 70s. She was diagnosed with MS many years ago. I think, I don't want to get it wrong, but I'm pretty sure it's over 40 years. And so when you enter, the world of We Are Ill, you are quickly embraced and it gives you hope. So yeah.
Specifically, you mentioned the meetings online, the progress reports, but if someone starts to engage with We Are Ill, what kind of opportunities will they have to work with you all to learn and to sort of have the same experience that you've mentioned?
Yes, so we have our private Facebook community. We also are going to be in Dallas this Saturday for our community meetup, and it's a time for fellow sisters in MS, as well as their support system, their support squad, their partners, spouses, family, friends, caregivers, to all come together, fellowship, have a good time, connect, share each other's stories, help each other. It's a vibe, and we're going to have food and drink, music. It's going to be a time. And we also have our signature event, which is our Wellness Weekend. We will be hosting our third in-person Wellness Weekend in November 1st through 3rd in Atlanta, Georgia. So that is a 3-day retreat where we have informational sessions, panels, we have speakers, we have happy hours, we have a wonderful music performance this year. Our musical performer is our fellow sister in MS, Jennifer Holliday. She is an actress and singer. She is the original Dream Girl. So we're really thrilled to bring her to Wellness Weekend, as well as a litany of experts on the Black MS experience and fellow MS patients. So those are a couple ways. We also have virtual programming. So if you go to our YouTube, you'll see videos educating our community on participating in clinical trials, how to advocate for yourself. We are going to be moving soon to regular cadence of virtual meetups. We are a national organization, but we are small and mighty, so it's a little challenging for us to be everywhere all at once. And so our virtual meetups will provide an opportunity on a regular cadence for our community to engage in person. Well, face to face, you get to see people on screen and things like that versus, just sending a message in the Facebook group. So yeah, and we also really proud of our professional patient masterclass that we hosted in March, which is MS Awareness Month, where we had, it was a full day of programming where we talked about everything from, again, self-advocacy to the mental health aspect of living with multiple sclerosis. And at the end, all of our participants received a certificate of completion. So they're now professional patients.
Professional patient. Can you break that down a little bit more? Are you saying someone who really knows how to advocate for themselves, someone who takes it, being a patient, treats it like a job and is very serious about how they approach it, the knowledge they bring to the table? That's what I'm assuming, but I would love to hear you detail more.
Yes, you're definitely in the right line of thinking. So when you live with a chronic illness, like, you eventually become a professional patient in the sense that you have to advocate for yourself. You have to keep tabs on all of your appointments. You gain a care team. So it's not just, you know, your, you know, primary care doctor that you see a neurologist, you might see a physical therapist, or an occupational therapist. You see a nutritionist. Sometimes you see so many different people, a therapist. So it encourages you to be at the forefront and really take your health into your own hands, because no one is going to advocate for you like you can yourself. And so when we say professional patient, we envision someone who is really confident and secure in their patienthood and someone who knows what to do to get the care that they need. So that means speaking up at doctor's appointments, coming in with notes, logging your changing symptoms, all of those things.
That's something that a lot of people should take note of, even mm-hmm. if they don't have an MS sort of diagnosis. Talk to me about sort of how you have come along in your journey in terms of feeling stronger as an advocate, and what that has meant for you to be empowered in that way.
Yeah, so I was going through it when I was diagnosed. I am not going to lie. It took me a minute to really gain my footing. And once I, you know, grieved my diagnosis, I really like decided, you know, MS isn't going to control me. Like I'm in charge of my life as to the extent, you know, that I can be. So I really started, you know, finding community, finding groups like We Are Ill, doing research, my own research on what MS looks like for the Black population. And then once I, you know, got a bigger grasp of what MS could look like, I then began to help other people who were newly diagnosed. And so I actually wrote a self-help memoir called Jesus Year. And it's the guide that I wish I was given when I was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. So I have shared that with a number of people, and I get their good reports about how the book has helped them along as far as, you know, finding a good neurologist, finding a care team, pursuing their dreams in spite of MS. You know, life doesn't end with MS. You know, you can have a family if that's what you choose. So you can have an illustrious career. You could travel. You can do anything you want to. MS is not stopping any show. So I've lived with MS now for 6 years, and I can say I'm a completely different person than that girl who was sitting in the doctor's office and sobbing next to my dad when I got the news that I got, you know, that I was diagnosed with MS. So leaps and bounds. And the longer you live with MS, the more comfortable you feel with your life. So that's our message with We Are Ill. We are redefining, again, we're redefining what sick looks like. It looks like us, and we are living full and happy lives. Not to say that MS doesn't get us down, and you know, it's a challenge to live with an invisible illness like multiple sclerosis, but we are giving it everything we have.
You said it's difficult living with a sort of silent, you know, an illness that people can't see.
Yeah.
Let's talk about that, because mm-hmm. I think that part of this obviously is to let people here in DFW know that you all will be here, that you're, you know, wanting people to be aware of this opportunity to connect and engage and be a part of the community. But also, what's your message to people who don't see it and maybe don't know a lot about it, about how important it is to just be mindful that people do, there are people yeah. who have illnesses that you can't see. And I'm not sure maybe how that affects your journey, like when you have. So because, you know, this is a new thing for me as well, right? Like mm-hmm. listening to someone who's saying, I may not look fit, but I am. What does mm-hmm. that, what do you want people who are looking to know about that?
Yeah, so I would say everyone is fighting invisible battles, not only the people who are chronically ill, but just know that there are people amongst you who are, you know, dealing with things that are huge, but because they don't necessarily have, you know, any mobility aids or anything externally that would indicate that they have challenges, you know, it doesn't negate their experience. And so I would encourage anyone who is new to knowing what MS is to Google it, to look us up. Our website is weareillms.com. We have an array of educational materials. We have a blog where we have our influencers, our ambassadors, talking about life with MS. We have our glossary of MS terms. And so it's, you learn a lot when you first are diagnosed with MS. It's like alphabet soup with the acronyms, the DMTs and all those things. So I would just encourage someone who doesn't know what it is to just educate themselves and have an open mind about it, because you may not know who, amongst you is actually living with MS. There's about 1 million people in the US who are, estimated to live with multiple sclerosis.
Thinking that, I have a friend who had a hip issue, and she just mentioned that even though it was something that she could rehab from, she'll never fully like walk the same, and she needs to sit down. And she's relatively a young woman, and she just said even that experience really reshaped how she looked at other people, because she feels like people looked at her strange if she didn't give up her seat for an older person, or if she was asking for some sort of accommodation, that people just kind of, wrote her off because she appeared to be sort of young and healthy. And why do you need that? And so she said, I will advocate for people with, sort of invisible illnesses as long as I can, just because you don't realize how often people are sort of either discriminated against or just not fully understood, and how that affects their experience just in day-to-day living and living with something that people can't see.
Yeah. Absolutely. It's a challenge. Even like we encourage people to, get help, get a handicap placard. I know that that's a big thing for people. They don't want to be labeled disabled, but it's going to help you ultimately. Get wheelchair service at the airport if you can't, walk that far. There's no shame in, advocating for yourself and getting the help that you need.
I'm going to ask you a little bit more about that and then get to my last question, because how much of that do you feel like you encounter? That it's not just, people get the diagnosis, they find the community, they find the support, but what kind of challenges or what do you face when you try to get people to embrace maybe adding, maybe the extra requests for accommodations, but that may be a big part of their identity. They're already kind of dealing with all the changes, but to your point, they don't want to look like they have a disability. They're afraid of the shame that may be attached with that. So how much of your work is also just battling stigma that might be a barrier to people getting the care that they actually need to improve their quality of life?
Yes, we do encounter that all the time. We as Black women, the strong Black woman trope or myth of the strong Black woman, we are people too. We hurt, we fear, we have a lot on our shoulders. And so we do encourage our community to get that help. And we reiterate that there's no shame in, getting the care that you deserve. Like, why suffer when you could be, getting, moving through life with help and assistance and not struggling. I think it's a personal thing. It's something that you need to, process and go through on your own. For me, that was part of my grieving process. And, thankfully with therapy and just living a little bit longer with this condition, it just reminds me that, why take the hard road when there is people who are willing to support and help you? And so that's something that we do at We Are Ill. We try to help our community and by letting them know about the resources out there that exist and encouraging them and telling them, we're very transparent. Like, look, I use it myself. I think that that is something that really helps our community get a grip on their new reality with MS.
You mentioned earlier that that was something that you in the doctor's office was one of the many things you were grappling with. It's like, how will my life change and will these dreams come true? What are some things that have happened? You mentioned you're a different person since then, but what are some of the things, the milestones, the whether it's accomplishments or just like the shifts in your mentality that have happened that you maybe didn't think were possible initially when you were diagnosed?
Yeah. So thankfully, I got married last year, July 15th. I walked myself down the aisle with my father to meet my husband at the end of the aisle. I have, you know, I'm a former journalist and, you know, writer by trade. And so I did author my book Jesus Year, and it became a bestseller on Amazon in April 2021. And I also recorded the audiobook for that myself. And just, you know, traveling the world, going to Oktoberfest in Munich, going to London, joining We Are Ill, being a part of the change that I wanted to see. I have bigger dreams, you know. I want to, you know, continue writing more books. I want to continue to help other people and lead them on their journey to authorship too. So just know that MS is not stopping anything.
So much. Last question. For the folks who are in DFW, can you share with them what they should know about the upcoming opportunity to engage?
Yes. So we will be hosting our community meetup. It's this Saturday, August 3rd at Work 214 co-working and office space. So that's on 3400 Oak Grove Avenue on the third floor here in Dallas, Texas. And it will be a wonderful time. Bring your friends, your family, your spouses. We will fellowship. We will just get to know each other. Why we wanted to host the meetup here is we want to directly engage with the Black MS community. So not only just people living with MS, but their supporters. And we feel like by establishing a presence in cities like Dallas, we're going to create meaningful connections and just foster a stronger supportive network. So that's why we're coming to Dallas. I hope you'll show up and just have a good time with us. Literally, it's going to be the best time. We might even do the wobble. Who knows? We wobbled at our last meetup in the DMV area. So come one, come all. And it's completely free.
Ashley, is there anything that I didn't ask or that you wanted to add that you feel like we missed?
I just wanted to say that, you know, MS can be a frightening disease, but just know that it gets better. It's, you know, maybe a little daunting to know that there's not yet a cure for that. We have amazing researchers working on that, and hopefully we'll see a day when MS is eradicated. But until then, continue to live your best life and know that there's people out there who are rooting for you, and We Are Ill as one of them.
Ashley Ratcliffe-Lundy for being with us today from We Are Ill. And thank you all for joining this community conversation.
Thank you.